Our scripture this morning comes from the Old Testament, from the prophet Isaiah. Now, if we read, we can learn so much about Jesus and about God and about what God expects of us. So hear the words of God through the mouth of Isaiah this morning from chapter 56, where it says, "Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. Happy is the mortal who does this, the one who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath, not profaning it, and refrains from doing any evil. Do not let the foreigner join to the Lord, say, 'The Lord will surely separate me from his people.' And do not let the eunuch say, 'I am just a dry tree.' For thus says the Lord to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me and hold my fast covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name and shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, I will gather others to them besides those already gathered." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I hope y'all haven't made liars out of me this week. I was with some friends of mine that are clergy people, and we were talking about our congregations, and I was telling them about how smart you all are, that ours is a really multilingual congregation, and we can talk and speak and understand numerous, you know, different languages. So you got to help me out here. How many of you all speak Italian? Raise your hand, please.
Oh, you know Italian restaurants.
Well, we do know some words, don't we? Rigatoni, marinara, Alfredo, pasta, macaroni. So, see, you do know some Italian. So on that point, I'm not gonna lie. How about Spanish? Who speaks Spanish? Sure, taco, con carne, burrito, quesadilla. And that big one, margarita. I knew somebody would be there with me. Gracias. And there are Greek and Hebrew words that we should know. We need to know them. Feta is Greek. Baklava is wonderful. Lagos means word. Christos means Christ. Kyrios means Lord. Koinonia means community. Agape means love. Maranatha means come. And let's talk about Hebrew. Who knows what Torah means?
The first five books
of the Bible, which is commonly called the law. Torah in Hebrew is law. We know the word Yahweh, which technically is not capable of being translated, but we know it as God. And we certainly know the last word of the service, and that means that's Amen. Now, that does not mean, let's go. Just for your edification, that means, so be it. Well, this morning I want us to learn two more words in Hebrew so that when I talk to my friends and tell them how multilingual you are, I can honestly say, and they're still striving to learn more, okay? Two words that we need to learn. The first one is mishpat. Say it, mishpat. Say it again, mishpat. That means justice. The second word that we need to learn is zedekah. Zedekah, which means righteousness. Mishpat, justice. Zedekah, righteousness. Hang on to those two. Less than a month ago, when I was up in New York City and in Washington, D.C., we visited for 3 days with my youngest son. And Tim has done just yeoman's work on our family genealogy. And we have found out going into the 17th century where some of our roots are. We found out, for instance, on my dad's side, I know exactly when my name became Russell, because it was changed from Roussel because I came from French Canada and Quebec. And I know when all of these things happened, it was about six generations. On my mom's side, we know what went on up in Hohenwald and around Linden, Tennessee, and we're still looking around, seeing what's going on there. Ann's family has been, we've discovered a lot of things with her toward New Bern, Tennessee. And the good news is, so far, there are no skeletons in the closet. But I'm not going to promise if we dig deep enough, there won't be. But in the evening that we sat looking at old pictures that Tim sees to be the one that everybody sends old pictures to, there's a picture of me when I was about 11 or 12 years old. And I spent every summer in upstate New York, and there's a picture of me in my brand spanking, never been grass stained, still creased and sparkling baseball uniform. And I had my cap on at the right jaunty angle. And it was something that fit me. There weren't gaps between the buttons like I encountered today. And if I do say so myself, I looked sharp. Not only that, I was crouched down in a proper batting stance, and I had my hands cocked just like I'm supposed to have them and like a professional is supposed to have them. I had my tush stuck out in the backside so that I looked like I was getting ready to lean into the ball, and I looked like a really good ball player and looked like I knew what I was doing. Well, at the side of the picture was a picture of our coach. And my coach's name is Louie Wheeler. And I was scared to death of Louie Wheeler, because Louie Wheeler didn't brook any foolishness. And Louie Wheeler expected you to come to ball practice, and for an hour and a half, you forget everything else in the sun, under the sun, and you learn to play ball. Because he understood that looking good, having that wonderful uniform, having just the right angle of my hat, and that glare at the picture didn't do one thing. That was just a pose that everybody struck. So that if you looked at that picture with no action around it, you thought, this person, and in this case it was me, you know, he could do it all. And what Louie instilled in me and in all of us on that baseball team is that if you are going to be a good baseball player or a good pianist or a good whatever, you've got to do more than just strike the proper pose. And he instilled in us that we are not to be posers. And as I thought about that word, I hadn't thought about it in years, and I can hear Louie saying, you don't want to be a poser. And that's someone who attempts to be something that he or she is not. You know, a poser struts trendy stances. A poser fakes great moves. Posers, P-O-S-E-R-S, puff out their chest and say, look at me. And, oh gosh, I wish Herb Butts was here this morning, because he's probably the only one that will recognize what I'm about to say. I had a wonderful baseball glove that was Gilbert Dougal model. I had a baseball bat that was Duke Snyder model. In fact, that baseball bat is still existent, and I know where it is. I had that super stylish uniform. But even with all of the paraphernalia, if all I did was sit around and look good, what do I accomplish? What has been done? Take that a step forward to about 35 years ago when I was with a large jewelry firm here in Memphis, Broadnax, and I was given the store in Germantown to be the manager. And everybody thought that that store in Germantown ought to be just sitting there raking money in hand over fist because it's sitting out there in the middle of massive affluence. And I went, and after 6 months, the dollar business just was not there. I was concerned about it, my bosses were concerned about it, and we couldn't quite put a finger on it until somebody realized that even being in the middle of affluent Germantown, and in a great location, and in a great place, among people that live in great big houses, and there ought to be a lot of money, if you looked deeply at that situation, those people living in those houses had 2.3 kids in private school. There went their money. They were driving great big cars and wearing Rolex watches so they could pose as having a lot of money. I went to one of my customers' house one day for some reason, and I don't remember what it was, and I walked in, and into the entryway was beautiful, and on the right was the living room, and on the left was what should have been a dining room. Well, the living room was wonderful. The dining room had nothing in it and had sheets over the window because they couldn't afford furniture for the dining room. But by golly, you drive by that house and you see that great big 6,000 square foot house, you automatically think, what? Woo! Those folks got some money. Those got some money. The most obvious thing to me is that every one of us have been posers in some way or other for most of our lives. The teenage years, adolescence is prime time for posing. Because on one hand, you're trying to fit in. You're trying to stand out. And you're trying to act grown up when you think you should be acting grown up. But on the other hand, you try to act like you don't care when you really do. And the posing that we learn to do so well in high school and in college generally will follow us all of our adult lives and into our careers. And what happens is that if you will think about your life, nobody really knows how you got to be a grown-up, do you? We just got there. And we all just keep posing at what it is we're supposed to do. And we pose through our teen years, and we pose through our late teen years and early 20s, and one day, that pose, when we reach adulthood, is all that we have left. Anybody who's ever had a doctor or a nurse hand them a tiny infant, a completely helpless baby, and put it into those unprepared arms, knows immediately what it's like to be a poser. I remember when they handed me that in St. Bernard Hospital in Jonesboro, Arkansas. And you know, I was 23, 24 years old, and I knew everything there was to know, my friends. And they handed me that baby, and I was scared to death. But I never let those nurses or doctors know. I struck my pose. I'm a smart man. I love this baby, and I know what to do. Right. That was the pose. We pose at parenthood, though, for so long that it becomes our natural posture. It's who we are, and the truth be known, our kids come to believe that we are real parents. So